Alright, so resuming poly class. We've had a bit of a hiatus between classes, but we're picking up again, looking at chapters 13 and 14 in the poly primer. And the first thing that's introduced here is a couple of new conjugations of verbs. So up until now, we've seen verbs which, between the root and the suffix, there's the letter A. So for example, pachati. Pachati, we have the root touch, and then the letter A between the root and the suffix T. So now we're saying the same thing, but it's exactly the same. It's just using either the letter E or aya, so aya. So these can be used interchangeably. As we see in some of these examples, we have desaimi and desayami, desaisi, desayasi, desaiti, desaiati. So in each of these examples, we're seeing that for the most part, it takes the same form of verbs that we've seen so far. So there's a root, des, and a suffix, mi. The only difference is the vowel that comes between the root and the suffix. And the slight complication with the verbs that use e is that sometimes you'll see aya instead. So as here, desaiti or desaiati. Otherwise, it's exactly the same as the verbs we've already looked at. All the suffixes are exactly the same. Any questions on that? Straightforward enough. Then there's similarly, there's some verbs which between the root and the suffix, they use na. Again, with sunati, for example, the root is su, which means to hear or to listen. The suffix is ti, and between the root and the suffix, we have na. Now, otherwise, it's exactly the same as any other verb that we've seen so far. There's a couple of cases that are worth pointing out here. So with the absolutive case, sometimes you will not see the na in between. So sutva simply is using the root plus the suffix tva, the absolutive suffix, without using that na in between whatsoever. So it's just sutva. And that's what you'll more commonly see. Sunitva, while theoretically a form that's possible, realistically, you'll most likely see sutra. Yeah.
Sorry, my question is about the infinitive.
Okay. And the infinitive, sunatung and sotung. So sotung, again, is using the root. What's different here is that it's using vowel gradation, whereby a U is strengthened into an O. And we'll talk about vowel gradation later because it's something which the next step up from that, by the way, is ava. So we'll see that when we talk about the to be verbs. We'll see a clearer example of this in particular.
My question is about the. It looks like an N. I don't know what it's called.
Which one?
The one with the lengthening on the right side.
Oh, like the one that looks like a cross between an N and a J.
Yeah.
That is.
Well, normally in the poly primer, they have the infinitive of sunati spelled with that instead of the M.
Oh, well, and the M with the dot is pronounced like NG, which is exactly the same
Oh, okay.
As like the N with the tail.
Okay.
I don't like the N with the tail. I strongly prefer the M with the dot. But it just signifies the nasal sound, like the NG sound. Just while I was mentioning vowel gradation, I'll just briefly mention the other vowel gradation that we'll commonly encounter. One second while I turn off. So that's the other one. So we already saw a sample of this up here with desayati and desayati. We can see that relationship between I and aya. And that's coming from I. So I becomes I becomes aya. So that's vowel gradation, which again has not been introduced yet in the Pali Primer. But since it's relevant to what we're seeing here, I'm mentioning it here. Yeah.
So the NA verbs, besides there being NA, doesn't do anything to the meaning?
No. No, the NA that appears between the root and the suffix has no meaning. It's just there to separate the root from the suffix. Okay. And here we can also see why. So there's the root and the suffix, and then the root doesn't end in a consonant, it ends in a vowel. So here, for example, putch, the root putch ends in a consonant, so consonant, vowel, suffix. That's fine. Here it would be vowel, vowel, suffix, which wouldn't work so well. So then we would have su-a-ti. Swati doesn't look right. So instead we have su-na-ti. Or more precisely, su-na-ti.
Are those two ends different?
What's that?
How are those two ends different?
It's with the placement of your tongue. So with the dot under the end, your tongue is a bit farther back, like touching the roof of the mouth, but a little bit farther back. With no dot, the tongue is completely against your teeth.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you really want to learn this, you need to talk to somebody who was raised speaking Hindi or Sinhala or other such Indic languages, because they know how to pronounce these consonants properly. I don't. I try, but I don't. So I'm not the best person to ask as to how to properly pronounce that distinction. I can tell you academically, but I'm not trained in speaking it precisely correctly. Okay, are we good on that? Pretty straightforward. Next, here's vowel gradation. I mentioned it separately down here already. So the to be verb, which, as we find in many languages, is does not follow exactly the same pattern as we're used to seeing in other verbs. So they come from two roots. So from the root us, we get the atti series. So asmi, asma, asi, atta, atti, and so on. These are all from the root us. Also santi is also from the root us. So what we see here is us as the root plus nti. Then we would wind up with three consonants in a row, which is simply not permitted in Pali. So instead, they switch around the first two letters so that we don't have three consonants in a row. Make sense?
Mm-hmm. Creative solution.
It is a creative solution. And the verb santi, and so from santi we get several related forms like satta and santa, which is santa, not santa. So santa, and some other related forms which come up from time to time. So it's good to be aware of that santi form of the verb to be.
And that would be like the second or first person?
This one? This is third person plural. Santi is third person plural.
Sorry, I meant santa or...
We'll get to those when we come to them.
Oh, okay.
So I mentioned
those are other...
Yeah, I mentioned it briefly now.
So that we're not surprised later.
Yeah.
But they're not tenses that we've learned yet.
Don't worry about it. We'll get to it when we come to it. Those are actually used as present participles. So we already know present participles. But what we don't know is why satang would be a present participle. But we will know when we come to that, which is not now.
Great.
Yes.
How do you translate the to be verbs? Like, how would you translate?
So, atti means there is, asi means you are, asmi means I am, asma, we are, atta, all of you are, santi, they are. So atti in particular is a very common word in the suttas. So that's one to be aware of. Asmi, we've probably all heard as asmi mana. So asmi means I am, mana means conceit. So asmi mana is the conceit I am, the conceit of self-existence.
Is there a difference between the different forms of to be?
Not particularly, no. No.
They're used interchangeably.
More or less. The derived forms are used differently, but strictly in terms of the verb to be, they're used the same. But like the nouns derived from them are used differently. Again, we'll talk about that when the time comes, but satang, which means existing, also has the sense of true or good. Whereas from the root bu, which we get the verb bhavati or hoti. Well, from that we get words like bhava, existence, being, becoming. But also we get bhavana, which means bringing into being, developing, or meditating. They're both from the same root, but they're used in different ways. Again, I mentioned vowel gradation because here's another example where we see it. So the u, o, ava series, we see clearly with the root bu. So bu, bhavati, hoti. These are all coming from that same vowel gradation of u to o, to ava. So we see that clearly here. Also, we see another lovely little sample of some transformation here of BH becoming simply H under certain circumstances. So this is one case of it. So from the root bu in hoti, the B has disappeared entirely, and we just have the H. So bhavitva and hutva. If you looked at these two words, you would think they were not possibly from the same root. They are, in fact, from the same root. They're from the root bu. Does everyone see why?
Mm-hmm.
Is anyone completely confused? I see one person nodding, but that's okay. You can continue to be confused. That's permitted.
So if we see a random word in Pali,
yes,
and we're trying to figure out what the root is,
look it up in the dictionary.
Will the dictionary have the different forms?
Hopefully.
Okay.
Generally speaking, the root is the first syllable, generally speaking. The first syllable after any prefixes, of course. So pari bhava, the
pari.
Prefix is pari,
mm-hmm.
But then after pari, the first vowel is bhava. And since you're already familiar at this point with vowel gradation, you will recognize that ava is part of that first syllable. Specifically, again, it's from pari bu. So from that, you would recognize that the root is just bu.
So that seems the root is just bu.
Okay, I see head shaking. Is this too much?
So I see how I could identify that when I see an ava. But it seems a little bit harder to identify it in the case of hoti, because I would probably just be like, I can't just in my mind try replacing every O with a U, or do I have to?
If you're really trying to hunt down the root,
mm-hmm.
then yeah. But the other thing is that the root will generally use the simplest vowel in the vowel gradation series.
Mm-hmm.
So the root will usually be U.
Mm-hmm.
So like bu
but
is the root, not bo or bhavati. The
right.
root is bu.
Like those are sort of things. Like I see a word that's conjugated and has prefixes, and I'm trying to figure out like the root so that I can look up the word.
Mm-hmm.
That's the scenario.
Well, prefixes are not usually a problem because there's only a small number of prefixes in Pali. So you'll very quickly learn.
Yeah.
I could list them. There's less than 10, I think. So once you know the What's that? We'll get to that. I don't want to go into it right now, because we're already adding more to the chapter than there is in the chapter. But yeah, there's only a handful of prefixes, so once you learn what the prefixes are, you'll look at a word and you'll just immediately recognize, like, Patti Sang Chikati. You'll look at it and you'll immediately recognize, okay, Patti is a prefix, Sang is a prefix. So the verb here is just Chikati. So what is Chikati? Well, we don't know because we haven't gotten to that yet. But the point is that you'll immediately recognize these are just prefixes. So in looking for the root, I can disregard the prefixes and just look at the verb itself and figure it out from there.
But I don't...
Patti Sang Parati would be a better example because this follows more clearly. Well, actually, it's a verb we already know for that matter.
So my question is, so Atti and Karoti and Bhavati and Hoti are considered irregular verbs, right? So, I mean, so
well,
when you look
somewhat
up,
irregular.
Right, but I, so dictionaries would list their different forms.
Yeah, they'll often list them in full,
right.
because you need to list them in full.
Because they're slightly irregular.
Yeah.
So. Okay.
Okay, does anything here need further explanation? Is anybody still confused about how Bhavitva and Bhavitva are from the same root? Nobody's confused about that? Okay. Is anybody...
How would the to be absolutive? What is that? Like how
the absolutive means like having been.
Oh, okay.
Or after being.
After being.
Yeah.
Oh yes, after.
Yeah. Having been is probably the easiest way to take it.
Or having become?
That having become. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, having become.
So wait, first, second, and third is what?
First person, I am. Second person,
okay.
You are. Third person, it is.
But, okay, so you're putting, what is weird to me, it's, so this is indicativo, and you would say
in
Italian. Yeah.
If you talk to me in that, I'll understand. But I know Spanish, so but they're very similar.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Good. So there are different. Infinito is different from. So infinitive is different from indicative?
Yes.
So why are they all like.
Because these are just the forms we know so far.
What's your question?
That makes no sense. Like there's
no sense.
Having first, second, third, then where are the other persons, and why is then absolutive and infinitive, which are two two different conjugations, then it seems like it's first conjugation, second conjugation, third conjugation, then absolutive conjugation and infinitive. That's why I'm confused.
Indicative.
So
I don't understand your question.
That is just a little confusing, that graph. So why are there not the other persons in the indicative? Why is it like all matched up?
Well, absolutive does not have multiple persons.
I know that, but where...
Infinitive does not have multiple
persons.
But
why... Maybe you didn't define that it's like indicative first and indicative second and indicative third. It just
okay, well, they're indicative first, indicative
and
second.
And where are the other
persons
of the indicative?
What do you mean other persons? There's only first,
no.
Second.
Oh,
third.
Plural. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
singular
yeah.
And plural. There's first person, second person.
So are these
person,
the only...
It's all indicative, present, active voice.
And that's the only... These are the only three conjugations that you have in Pali?
What
in
do you mean?
English?
Indicative, absolutive, infinitive.
Mm-hmm.
This is just all we've learned so far in this textbook.
Okay.
There's more.
Okay, and that's
there's
why I was confused.
But this is all we've learned so far. There's actually not a lot more. I'll also give you the declension chart that I put together, which...
I was making my own.
Well, that's also a great exercise.
Yeah.
Making your own will teach you a lot. But I'll give you mine, which is very useful. I'll give you a little preview, briefly. This contains everything you need to know in order to read poly. Oh. One page, everything you need.
There's a lot of shorthand there.
There is, but the shorthand is all very readily explainable. So you're asking for multiple forms. There's present, there's imperative, there's optative, there's
okay.
past, there's passive, there's causative, optative, future, and conditional.
Okay.
There's past participle, present participle, future participle, all in active and passive form.
Mm-hmm.
There's infinitive and absolutive, and to top it all off, there's middle voice.
Okay,
so
yeah, so that makes
other
more sense
verb forms.
To me.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, what the hell is middle voice? You won't actually find any clear explanation anywhere as to what middle voice is. Realistically, it always seems to take the basic form of indicative. But it's like a more lofty or poetic or something. So you almost always see it in poetry. You rarely see it in prose.
Okay.
So that's middle voice. It's more like I'm being fancy voice.
Yeah, it's like old English.
Yeah.
Well, old English is not actually English anymore.
Okay, that's beside the point.
Yes.
My metta evaporated when the retreat ended. That was a joke. Joke? Funny.
You had metta language.
Some people thought I did. Anyway, my metta is still here. It's just changed form a little bit. Any further questions on this? Besides adjust table call.
Well, admittedly, it's a little confusing.
Adjust table bro. Maybe.
Oh.
What's up?
So, in terms of the absolutive, an absolutive can modify or go with any noun at any part of the sentence. And, right? I mean, I guess we'll see when we get to the example.
Generally speaking, what you find is absolutive phrases. So you'll see a phrase like, after going to the monastery and after petting a cat, then she studies poly.
Mm-hmm.
So, from that, we know that the main actor in the sentence, namely she, is the one who is doing the actions in the absolutive phrases.
There were, we'll get to them, but there were a couple of examples where the absolutive seemed to apply to the direct object instead.
That's possible. So we'll look at those examples.
Okay.
It's almost always clear from context or from sentence placement
mm-hmm.
what the absolutive is referring to. But usually it's the main actor in the sentence.
Is there a... I'm sure you may have covered this in a previous class, but is there a prescribed... I forget which one is inflected and which one is not inflected, but...
Well, it won't make a difference because I don't know what either of those terms means.
I think declining things and conjugating things means it's inflected.
Okay.
In Latin, for example, word order doesn't really technically matter. Like,
yeah, it doesn't matter much in poly either.
Okay.
It matters under certain limited circumstances, but for the most part, it doesn't really matter.
Okay. Alright.
Yeah. Okay, are we good on to be verbs for now?
Yeah.
Okay. We're all experts on vowel gradation?
No.
No.
Okay,
we'll
that's fine. It took me a long time to understand vowel gradation. And then finally, the other thing that's introduced in chapters 13 and 14 is future tense. So future tense is very simple. You just stick this issa insertion, I don't know the right word to use for this, you just stick it between the base and the suffix. So very simple. So bhavisati means it will be. Karisati means it will act, it will do, it will make. Sunisati means it will hear or it will listen. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That all make sense?
I think technically it's called an infix.
Infix?
Like prefix, postfix, and infix.
Interesting. I've never heard that word before, but it makes sense.
It's a funny name.
It is.
at least that's what we call it in like computer science. I don't know if that was taken properly from linguistics or not. But.
Okay,
yeah.
So let's start looking at some examples and translating some of these sentences or attempting to. So everyone's favorite part. So first one, let's start going through this. Mayang dhammang uganhitong usahanta panditena saha mantema.
The dhamma.
Okay, you know one word, that's
we.
Great.
We.
Correct. We. First off, what is the declension of we?
Subject.
Nominative.
Good.
Plural.
Correct. That's why it's we. What about dhamma? What's this word mean? Giovanna?
The dhamma.
Correct. And what is the declension?
Accusative.
Yes. Accusative what?
Singular.
Great. How about uganhitong? Can someone take a stab at the declension at least?
Is it a present participle?
No. Though that's a good guess, but no.
To learn?
So you got the form correct, so that's called the
infinitive.
Yeah, so to do something is the infinitive. Uganhati literally means to take up or to pick up, but the applied meaning can be to learn. But literally it means to pick up. So correct?
That's a present participle.
Usahanta, correct. That's a present participle. Mom. Why is it a present participle?
Because it's declined like a noun, but it's a verb.
It is correct on both counts.
So it's in nominative plural.
Nominative plural. Okay, yeah. Nominative plural matching with what else in the sentence?
The subject.
Yeah, with we. And what does it mean, usahanta? So it is indeed a present participle.
Trying,
correct. And panditena? Instrumental, correct.
Singular,
correct.
With the wise men.
Correct.
Men.
Singular, wise men. And what is saha?
Well, saha is with.
With, correct. Mantema. Declension, can anyone stop at the declension? You guys seriously haven't learned verb suffixes by now?
No, I'm looking at the verb, not the suffix.
Oh, well, there's only six suffixes.
Present,
and we already know the
present
subject.
Present active plural.
First person.
We discuss.
So, we discuss, correct.
We discuss the Dhamma with the white. What? No, we discuss. What?
We discuss the Dhamma with the wise men trying to learn.
But
no.
Why there's
no, trying
with
to learn
twice.
The Dhamma? We discuss. We take counsel with the wise men.
Yeah. Converse, take counsel, discuss.
Wait, why are there with? Why is there with twice?
Because that's just saha. Saha is technically unnecessary in sentences. So sometimes you'll see saha and sometimes you won't.
So it's redundant.
Unnecessary. Yeah.
There might be something in Italian because there's definitely something in Spanish where if you're talking to a person it has to take like a di or le.
No, when it's no, it's like English.
So let's
when
stick
to there's
poly.
With, there's with.
So rather than also incorporating Italian
just
and Spanish. So trying to learn the Dhamma, we converse with the wise man.
Yeah, it just confused me because I saw the with. So
yeah.
I thought there were like two instrumentals. So it's just like
this.
Emphasizing the fact that the thing before is an instrumental, so will it always be when an instrumental is there?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
okay.
No.
No?
It's occasionally used as part of a word compound. But yeah, generally speaking, you'll see it with instrumental.
What do you mean by word compound?
You'll see when we come to that. So word compounds are quite common in Pali.
These are a bunch of words getting jammed together to make a new word. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Like makeup.
Oh, that's a word compound?
Yes, like take over.
Here's one, actually. Sabba loke, that's a word compound. Papamite, that's a word compound. Devaputta is a word compound. Anyway, so we're going to see many examples very shortly.
Devaputta sounds really funny.
All right, so let's look at the next sentence. Yay! Buddha pasijitva upasiko devaputto hutva sabaloke upajati. Fun times. Correct. And what's the declension? It is probably accusative plural. What else could it possibly be?
Locative singular.
Correct. Those could both be correct. Pasidetra.
Past participle.
No. It is not a past participle. So what is that twa suffix? This is quite distinct.
Sorry, absolutive.
Absolutive, correct. And what is pasidati?
It's pleased.
Faithful.
Those are both possibly correct answers. Most likely in this case, it means placed faith in or gained confidence in. So,
it's
locative. So in that case, yeah, it would appear that Buddha is locative singular.
I mean, unless you translate having been pleased with, and then it would be Buddha. I mean,
yeah, it could possibly be accusative plural, as you mentioned.
Yeah.
So two multiple Buddhas, but in this case, it seems unlikely. It's possible, but unlikely. Upasaka.
Related
devotee. Yep. Devotee. Devaputta. Deva.
Baby, child.
Technically, it means a child of a deva, or a deva child, but the way it's normally used is just to mean a young deva.
Oh.
So putta means child?
Yeah.
That's similar to Latin, actually.
Well, they talk about Indo-European roots, about the peculiar similarity. What was that face for? You're being so mean.
How am I mean?
Because you keep making these like weird faces at me when I'm talking
to
you.
No, I'm not.
Broadcast.
I know.
By the way, remember I asked you a question about to be taking a nominative and whether or not it's defined the same way as a nominative. This is the same example.
Okay, well let's finish putting the sentence together and then we'll talk about how to compose
the
words.
So baby angel.
So baby angel.
And another
we'll go with young.
No, let's do baby.
And then another absolutive. Having become.
Okay. Having been or become. Okay, how about sagaloke upajati?
Is born into a heaven
now? Yes, so saga is heaven and loka is world.
Worlds.
Yeah.
Heaven worlds.
Well, in.
Oh,
okay.
Sorry.
Singular.
Single.
In heaven.
Okay. So. Let's put this all together. Does someone want to take a stab at what this means? Without making weird faces at me?
Having become in the Buddha.
Having gained faith in the Buddha. Something, something.
No, the devotee. Having been a young angel.
What?
Okay, fine.
Having gained faith in the Buddha. The devotee. Became reborn at the beginning, arises in heaven. Oh, haven't been a devotee.
Having gained faith in the Buddha, the devotee, having become a young deva, is reborn in heaven.
Bravo!
Where's the word reborn?
So in this
arises.
Case,
yeah.
both absolutives are still using the main actor in the sentence.
Yeah.
I was saying that. I was just putting the commas in different places. It's
yeah.
fine, whatever.
It was too tempting, though, to say how we become in a Buddha.
Well, why not use the word reborn like Alex says?
Oh, yeah, you can do that, too. But technically, upajjati just means one goes close or arrives at or reaches.
Why can't it just say that having gained faith in the Buddha, the devotee was reborn in heaven as a young angel? Instead of saying that having the devotee having become an angel or rises in heaven.
So these sentences were invented in order to help us learn Pali. So these are not sentences drawn from the suttas.
Okay.
So this is one of the criticisms that sometimes leveled at this particular textbook, is that rather than use actual sutta excerpts, they made up sentences.
Okay.
And the made up sentences sometimes are a little bit awkward or weird.
Yeah, it's fun. I like it because of that.
Yeah. By contrast, there's another Pali textbook called Introduction to Pali by A.K. Warder that uses only quotes from the suttas. And that has its own advantages and drawbacks. It's also a nightmarishly difficult book to use if you don't already know a lot of Pali, which is why we're not using that book.
Well, also, it's great because then, actually, since they made it up, it could be totally plausible that you're becoming in the Buddha.
They're not that
Okay, let's stay focused here. Keeping in mind that people are watching us from all around the globe.
Actually, now there's zero.
Wait, we actually had a non-zero number of watchers before?
Like, yeah. But right now, after my having become in the Buddha.
Yeah. Just like, what is this heresy?
Oh, we got two back.
Oh, good. Okay. That was because I called you a heretic. What was your question?
I wanted to take a stab at the whole sentence.
Oh, the one that we just did? Or
no,
the third one? Let's do it piece by piece first, and then you can put it all together. Punyankatu ichanta. Tumhe sapurasa papamite ovidesata.
Accusative singular.
So let's allow some other people to try. I really appreciate that you've put so much effort into learning Pali in such a short amount of time. It's a great sign. It means that you actually will learn Pali very quickly. But let's allow some other people to answer things. So punyang.
Merit.
Yay! And what is the declension?
Nominative plural?
No. Theoretically possible, but in this sentence, unlikely.
Accusative.
Yes. Katung. Okay, yes, we know you know the answer. Somebody else know the answer? Yes!
Wait, what is
How are you doing this when you don't have a book or notes or anything?
Wait, what is katum again?
What's the declension?
To do.
Okay, so everyone knows it's the to-do form, the infinitive form. So what is katum?
Speak.
No. It's one of the irregular verb forms that we just learned.
No, to do.
Yeah, to do or...
To make.
To make, yeah.
Oh,
in this
makes
case,
merit.
To make makes a bit more sense. But yeah, it can also mean to do. Yeah. So ichanta, what's the form?
Wishing.
Correct. So that means it is a
present participle.
Correct. Why is that a present participle? Exactly. It's because of the beats on the end. Precisely. Tumhe. If nobody gets it in the next 5 seconds, I'm going to let Devana answer.
Yeah, that's going to be the punishment, you guys.
You? Correct. How many U's? One U or many
U's?
Lots of U's.
Y'all.
Y'all.
Yeah. Sapurasa. Sapurasa.
Good man.
Yes, or good person in general. And what's the declension? Plural. Okay, we'll go with that for now.
Yeah.
What else could it be, by the way?
Adjective.
Could be adjective. Yeah.
Vocative.
Could be vocative plural. Not terribly likely, but it could be.
It's
like, oh, you good people. Actually, it could be in this case.
Yeah.
We'll consider that.
Oh, you good people wishing to make merry.
Actually, that was how I interpreted it.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a valid interpretation. How about Papa Mitte?
Something friend?
Something friend, correct. Mitta is friend, so that's Papa. I'll give you a hint, it's not your daddy.
Sugar?
What?
No.
No,
Anna, it is not sugar.
Oh, evil.
Yeah, which, as I've said, I don't like to use the word evil, but in this case, we'll stick with it. And what is the declension?
Plural. Accusative.
It could be plural accusative. What else could it be?
Yeah, locative, singular.
Okay. But probably it's plural accusative. And what's ovidisepta?
A verb.
Advising.
Advise. Good. Future. Correct. Well, you really can't restrain yourself.
It's a good practice.
It's great. It's like, I'm so excited that I know Polly.
Yeah.
No, I, trust me, I know that feeling. It's a really
good feeling. It's really exciting that, like I studied straight for 1 week and I caught up. I actually caught up.
Yeah. You actually caught up and you're actually, like, doing really well. So, ovidisepta. What does this mean? You've got most of it.
Is you, like the declension?
Great. You will advise. Wonderful. Great team effort, by the way. So we have her saying you, you saying future, you saying advise. It all comes together. So
you,
what is this
oh
sentence
good
saying?
People, will advise evil friends wishing to make merit.
You all wishing to make merit will advise you good people wishing to make merit will advise your evil friends.
Okay, we'll go with that. That's pretty good.
What's the alternative?
Does anybody want to suggest an alternative? Otherwise, that sounds perfectly suitable.
Evil friends will advise you to make merit. You good people.
Okay, that's funny, but no. And why is that not a valid interpretation?
Because evil friends is not the subject.
Correct. It is not in the nominative case. Next
one.
It was funny. Sachang yatung ichanto ahang samanehi panhe putami.
What?
So let's start at the front. Sachang.
Truth.
Ruth, correct. Probably accusative singular, yeah. How about nyatu? First off, it is a to-do form, so it's the infinitive form, that's correct. But what does the verb root mean? Nya. What does nya mean? Same word as from nyana, panya, nya. Yes.
What?
And this an easy way to remember this is nya sounds like no. Mm. Well, kind of. No, nya, no. Nya to know. Nyana, knowing.
Also sounds like you.
Now I know.
Yeah, now you know. How about Ichanto? We just saw a similar form of this quite recently.
Wishing.
Wishing. Yes. Ahung.
I.
Yes. Samanehi. From the monks.
Or recluses.
With is better. I prefer the word contemplatives for this. With contemplatives. So it could be from, it could be the ablative form. So we'll include that as a possibility. By including both possibilities. Hanpei?
Questions.
Yes. What's the declension? Javan?
Plural.
Okay. Plural, correct. Keep going.
Accusative.
Yes. And what's put chami? This should be an easy one. Javan?
I.
What are you calling?
Okay, so why do we know that this is I?
Me.
Me, yes, because it's me asking the question. Puchani is me asking. See how easy
is that
is?
Really like a...
That's actually how I remember it. That's how I remembered it in the beginning anyway.
And C is second person.
Yep. Yep. So I ask. So let's put it all together. What is this sentence saying, Javana? Boss lady.
Wishing to know the truth, I ask something with a contemplative.
Okay, you were doing pretty good, but you choked in the home stretch.
Wishing to know the truth, I ask questions from contemplatives.
Yep.
From contemplatives? Like,
I guess
I ask questions.
I don't ask questions with people.
I ask questions. Well, the way you would put that is, in English I say, like, I ask for answers from people. So it's odd here that I ask questions. Actually, I ask questions with contemplatives might make more sense.
Yeah.
Let's see. I'm just going to check here briefly. So the A, he, ending, he, instrumental, or ablative, plural. Yeah. Those are our only options.
In English, couldn't you render it as I ask questions of the contemplative?
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's how we would say it.
Okay. Just because there's no of in Pali, right? I mean, besides asa.
Yeah, that's the genitive, though, which wouldn't make sense here,
exactly.
Because that implies possession.
Right.
So yeah, that's how we would say it in English. I ask questions of the contemplatives.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's just because of an idiom in English that the with or from doesn't make sense?
Yeah.
Does in English the answers belongs to the one answering it?
Okay.
Doesn't matter.
No, I get what you're saying. Let's look at some more.
Mayangi
tani gayante nachante kumare olo kasama.
We?
We, correct. Gitani.
Wait, is that song?
Correct.
Songs.
And what is the songs? Good. How about gayante?
Singing.
Yes. Do you see the relationship between these two words?
Sort
mm-hmm.
of.
Vowel gradation. So remember, I
and
aya. So Gita and Gaya. So gayante, what's the declension here? Aww.
Nominative plural.
Yep. Nachante. One of those things that we don't do on the opposite today. Good. One of the things Javana is not doing right now.
Praying.
Oh, no, dancing. Kumare.
Boy.
Or boys, or what's the possible declension here?
Boys.
Declensions, possible declensions.
Accusative?
Could be accusative what?
Plural?
Yes, or what else could it be?
Locative?
Could be locative, in, on, or at, a single boy. So just to include a couple possibilities here, because this makes the sentence more fun to translate. Olo kasama.
Future,
correct. Future.
Second person plural.
Second person plural.
We.
And Oloka, what's that? Looks at. Yeah. We will
watch.
We will look at.
Or look at. I guess it would be look at the boy.
Yeah.
If it's look
at
the
boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can look at boys. See, Polly is fun.
Boys singing and dancing and singing.
So
songs.
Who's doing the singing and dancing?
Boys.
Correct. So let's put this all together into a coherent sentence. Boss lady, you're good at this part.
All right. We will watch. Can't say. We will watch something. There's no the English, this is the, but he has at boys, on in boys, so.
You will watch the boys.
Right,
yeah,
that's what they
dancing on the boys.
But that's what I'm saying, there's no they, so that's why I'm like, can I not use the word they? Okay, we will watch the boys singing and dancing.
Singing songs and
singing,
dancing.
Singing songs. Yeah,
yeah,
that's
there you go. Okay, perfect. Perfect. Yay!
I like the dancing on the boys better.
Yeah, I like dancing on the boys. I'm like trying to put together because it was so weird not having the actual word I know.
Okay, I'll stop asking you. You win.
No, I don't mind. I'm getting there. Something is happening.
Okay, that's good. Ahang acharyo homi, tvam vedro hosi.
I'm the teacher.
Teacher?
No,
I am, correct. I am the teacher, correct.
I, teacher, I am. In that case, you, doctor, you are.
Yeah, for a religion that has no self, that's like.
Wait, you doctor?
You, doctor, you are. Or you can put it back the same way.
It is.
You doctor. Oh my god. Yeah, teacher. Are you doctor yet? Talk to me when you doctor.
Good times. Okay, now she's paying attention. Okay, great. So we're now up to 8:30, so we normally end at 9. Before we go through the rest of these, do you have any specific questions you wanted to ask?
Oh, wait. So one of my questions was about the verb to be. I had asked you before if it takes accusative or nominative, but I think it takes nominative, based on the examples, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it?
Yeah, the other examples were one of the questions that's in the... Yeah, you don't have it here, so maybe we should...
Which one? Yeah, I don't include all the examples. I just picked a few that illustrate the...
Wait, actually... No, actually, it's this next one.
Oh, this one?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Then let's do it.
Okay.
Was that the only specific case you had a question about?
Yes.
Okay, great. Let's look at it then.
I have one for after that, just inserting in.
Fried rice? No, there was no fried rice in this sentence.
Are you projecting in the
Freudian. Okay, we're getting a little scattered here. Let's stay focused.
Curry.
Let's start going.
Until the point that I don't know?
Sure.
Okay. So I think that's a present participle declined with son, so it's also accusative singular.
Okay.
And then Surian is sun, accusative singular. Isla is absolutive, having seen the rising sun.
Good.
And then nominative singular.
Okay.
The Brahmin.
Good.
And then this is where it gets so nominative plural or ablative singular.
Okay. Probably ablative singular. What does it mean?
From the house.
Great.
And Nikama, I don't know. This is why I was like
Alex, Sunny, Nick Humba, does anyone remember this word?
I know Vandati means salutes, but that's...
Yeah, or worships.
Right.
Nick Humba.
Leaving?
Correct.
Yeah,
Nick Humba.
I know, but...
Yeah, so what's the form?
Right.
The form is absolutive. Absolutive. So one of the absolutive suffixes is ya.
Oh.
So nik kamati. So nikam ya becomes nikama.
Oh,
no.
Should be double k. Oops. So having left or after departing.
So.
In Vandati, he worships, or pays respects to, or venerates. So, what is this say? What is this sentence saying? What's going on here?
Having left the house. Go.
Having seen the sun, the Brahmin left the house after worshipping.
No, fail.
Having seen the rising sun, the Brahmin, after leaving the house, worships or venerates. But
worships. The sun.
I guess.
He's worshipping the sun.
Yeah.
Because he's not
Why?
Buddhist.
But
he's not Buddhist.
He's just a Brahmin.
But
he's not watching the sun, right?
It's because he's stuck with Sila Bhakti Paramasa.
I
offered this to the sun god.
I can't believe how many people say that.
I've seen the sunrise.
I appreciate their willingness to just roll with it.
So
it's
kind of cool.
Awesome. Yeah, it's.
They're like, I'm confused, but I'm willing to.
Yeah, I would have totally refused to say something.
Well, I would have just been like, wait, what? Sun god? Why are we giving food to the sun god?
Yeah.
I would ask questions.
Yeah.
I might roll with it, but I would ask questions. What blows my mind is people not asking questions. They're just like, oh, sure, yeah, we'll give this to the sun god. Hey, why not?
Surya
means sun,
mm-hmm.
And the declension is? Yes.
What's the declension?
Accusative. This is the declension. Like the NG sound, like song.
Oh, the
Yeah.
Okay.
Suriyang.
Suriyang.
It's the sun, to the sun. Okay.
So would it be actually, having seen the rising sun, the Brahmin, actually, having left the house, the Brahmin worships the rising sun after having seen it, basically.
Yeah.
Wait.
So it is something based on how do you say that?
Implied. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's implied here that he's worshiping the sun. It's
mm-hmm.
not mentioned, but that's what's implied.
Yeah.
So it's having seen the rising sun and having left.
Yeah.
The Brahmin worships.
Yeah.
But in this case, in English, it could be the house or the sun. But in this case, it's not.
Yeah. He probably wasn't worshipping the sun. Or he probably wasn't worshipping the house.
Well, we know
he
that
probably
in the Pali
was worshipping the sun.
It's not an accusative, right?
Yeah.
Like that
correct,
house.
It's ablative.
Yeah.
So you
yeah.
couldn't possibly be worshipping the house in Pali.
Yep.
That's correct. But he could be worshipping the rising sun. By the way, another note here, by the way, so Uddentam, Udd means up. So that's a prefix, up.
Oh.
We see it a few other places, Ugganhitom. The prefix is Udd. So Ugganhitom, up.
But Udd becomes Udd.
Yeah. So it just assimilates to the following consonant.
Oh, do you want to list the
prefixes? No.
What are the rules for the assimilations? Because in the MY case, it became MM.
Yeah.
Like it took the first and not the second. In this case, it's like the D and G.
Generally speaking, the prefix or the suffix is what will be morphed.
Ah, okay, that makes
not
sense.
Not always, but generally speaking.
Okay, so in this case, it would be in the prefix. It's the one that has to conform to the root.
Yeah.
I had one question from the exercises. If we could do Deepang Papatum Akan Kamana Mayang Samudang Tarikun.
Okay, say that again.
Deepang Papatum.
Papatum?
Not a long answer.
Why don't you just tell me where it is?
16 on exercise 14. So lesson 14, exercise number 16.
This one.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Okay, let's have a look at this. So.
The rice. No.
Leopard.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
There's no rice.
Sorry,
well,
what is
my
the
brain
what
messed
is the word for
the
rice? Is that
Udana
or
Udoka? Odana?
Odana.
Yeah. But more generally just means food.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Meal?
Or meal.
It's like gone.
Yep. Or con in Thai.
Okay, so let's stay a bit more focused here. If we start roping
lamp
into
or island.
Just, good. Lamp or island. And I think we're going to have to stop soon because I'm starting to get a bit tired. But we'll press on for the time being.
To attain?
Yeah, to attain or to reach. Akan kamana. Expecting or wishing to or hoping to.
We,
right? Samudra. I'll give you a hint. It's kind of like a big pot of water, only way bigger.
The ocean?
Great.
To cross?
Great. Navikam. So a naval yard has lots of navika.
They wear uniforms.
What's that?
Ships.
They wear uniforms.
Oh.
What?
Ships?
Yes.
Sailing.
Yeah,
sailing.
Ships or boats.
Oh.
So, a naval vehicle is a navika.
Oh,
naval, nava.
I thought it was... I thought it was sailor, not ship.
Oh, yes. I think you're right.
Okay,
yeah,
Navika,
sailor.
Yeah,
Navika sailor,
is
not ship.
Nava is ship.
What's that?
Nava is ship.
Yeah, okay. You're correct, sailor.
The sailor, I guess? Accusative?
Sailor. Yeah, accusative.
Okay.
Yeah, Paryesama.
Ah, pop. Is that the looking around, searching for?
Yep. Yep, we search literally means we look around. Yeah, the prefix pari means around.
Mm-hmm.
So, this looks straightforward enough.
Okay, and I don't know what my question
Divana?
Was.
Do you want to say what the sentence means?
Expecting to cross the sailor.
Expecting to cross the sailor, we search the ocean to reach the land.
I'm
searching to cross the ocean, the sailor. Search something for the
end. No. Okay, what does this really mean?
Expecting to reach the island, we search for the sailor in order to cross the sea. Or search to cross the sea.
Great, perfect.
Wait, why would you search for a sailor to cross?
Well, somebody has to pilot the boat. Right. I don't know how to pilot a boat. Do you know how to pilot a boat?
You learn.
Yeah, or you just find someone who already knows.
Yeah, like.
Well,
what
in either case,
the
sailor will have to be the one to teach you.
But why do you have land if the sailor?
Well, so you can see in the dark while you're crossing the ocean.
Expecting to reach.
But one pair of both.
Deepa can mean either lamp or island.
Oh, okay.
Two completely unrelated meanings.
But if you already know that you're talking about the ocean and crossing something, why put the lamp in it?
Well, because when we were translating the sentence, we hadn't gotten there yet. When we were just looking at the first word, we don't know what the sentence is about.
So why not even name it after something?
Okay, so while we're all getting sleepy and weird.
Can we try like the last six?
No, please.
I'll just try to go through them.
Okay. Yeah, you try.
Okay. Ruling or governing the men righteously, the kings avoid bad merit.
Polenta does not mean ruling or governing. Polenta means protecting. Is it translated as governing?
Rule or governing.
In the book?
Paleti, right?
Yeah, paleti means protect.
Yeah, rules or governs.
Yeah, that's wrong. It means protect.
Okay.
This is why it's great. We
yeah, like Dhammapala is a Dhamma protector, a guardian of the Dhamma.
Rakati to mean protect.
That also means to protect or to guard. Yeah, paleti means to protect.
Okay.
Does not mean to rule.
Oh, thank goodness, because there were some that were like, the kings are ruling, like, I rule this, or I am the king who rules this island, and it felt...
Yes, I protect this island. Yeah, that's, I don't know why they... There's a couple translations in the Pali Primer which I don't like. Actually, there's a few which I don't like, and a couple which I think are just straight up wrong. That's one which is just wrong. So, otherwise, what you were saying sounded pretty accurate. Say it again.
Protecting the men righteously. The kings avoid bad merit or
unwholesome.
Yeah, unwholesome.
Great.
Merit or whatever it is.
Great, you got that. Just means grain. This is another wrong translation.
Okay.
Danya means any kind of grain, not corn in specific.
Do they have corn?
I have questions about whether there was even corn in ancient India.
Yeah, that's debatable given that I don't think it grew there.
Exactly.
Okay, so having filled the bowl with grain, you will offer it to the teacher.
Yes.
Okay.
At the foot of a tree.
Having sat at the foot of a tree.
Good.
I will. Approach.
Yes.
Approach the monk or recluse sitting. Sewing his robe.
Correct. Sewing a robe. We don't know if it's his robe.
Oh,
it's not his robe. Otherwise, great. You're doing good.
Okay.
Do we need to piece this one apart first?
Mm.
Grata.
Oh, cloth.
Cloth.
But
which one?
Wait, there's two.
Retta? You said it's cloth?
Chariot.
Yeah.
I always, for some reason, that's the one word that like I always mistranslate. Because, oh, it's Vata. Oh, right. You, dwelling in the village, you, having gone to the city, will return or bring back the chariot.
Okay, Anasasi is you will bring back. I thought it was you will buy, but I might be thinking of a different word.
No, I don't think it's leave.
Again,
it's leave.
My
you
mind
will
is
leave
spacey.
The chariot or vehicle back. That's how they translate
okay.
it. As
okay, yeah. Yeah, that does make sense because the root here is naya or nati. So nati, or nayati means to guide or to lead.
They actually translate both anati and nati the same way.
Yeah, which is fair.
Oh.
Yeah, that's correct. Okay. Aham subandhan parye samane deepam ha'aga chante vanaje janami.
I know the merchant. Merchants.
Good. Or understands.
Who...
I know the merchants. Okay.
Wanting to attain gold...
Is that not a team?
No.
Searching.
Searching.
Oh, searching.
Good.
For,
searching.
So searching for
gold. Searching for
gold.
Good.
And coming to the island.
Coming.
The English there is.
Island. You know, island.
So I think let's piece this one apart because it's getting a little messy.
Gold. Searching.
Search.
From the island,
coming
merchants.
No, or understand.
I know the island, the merchants coming from the island searching for gold.
Oh.
Yeah, that sounds more reasonable. So, coming is in the same declension as merchants, so you know it's the merchants that are coming.
As it is.
And coming
searching.
From
yeah.
the other. Yep, and searching, also same declension as merchants. So, I know the merchants who are coming from the island searching for gold.
Oh.
It's almost like reading the sentence back to front. So, I know the merchants coming from the island searching for gold. Great.
Ooh,
good merit? Is that good merit? Wanting merit?
Ah, good times. Do we need to break this one apart first? Let's go ahead and break this one apart.
She's like, no, I want to race.
No,
this is not a competition.
So, it is.
Okay, great. That's one word.
wealth.
Dama.
Wealth.
Merchants.
Dana.
What about the merchants? What's the declension?
Plural. It could be genitive or
Data. Well, merchants are masculine, right? Yeah.
Some of them are feminine.
Well, the noun.
to do or to make, and that's present participle, so it modifies merchants.
Yeah, so making or doing.
Good merit. I think.
Good what? Kamma? Good kamma? Kamma doesn't mean merit. Punya means, come on, Jamana, you know the answer. What does punya mean? Punya. You answered earlier.
Good.
Merit.
Merit. Oh,
punya means merit.
Oh,
and what is kamma? What is kamma?
Meritorious deed.
Yeah, deed or action. Okay, so now that's putting it all together.
Yeah.
Just read it backwards. It is wealth for the merchants to know. Right.
How about doing meritorious actions
is wealth for merchants.
Merchants.
So in this case, the doing is the subject of the sentence.
Well, actually, wealth is the subject of the sentence, but
wealth, or more accurately,
the way you put it is that karo dhanam, but no, these are the same declension.
Yeah.
The merchants.
That's right.
The merchants.
I'm getting tired as well.
And wealth can't be.
The merchants
so
are doing meritorious
so
actions.
The wealth, there is wealth. Of or for the merchants who are making meritorious actions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it is. So the there is wealth.
There is wealth for merchants
who are making merit.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All together now? Okay. Done.
The end.
The end.